In this video, we're solving an elastic collision by transforming it into the center of mass reference frame. And this is a really cool trick because it allows you to completely circumvent all the nasty algebra that comes with solving elastic collisions in the lab frame. So the problem is broken up into actually four parts on a couple different slides, and we're going to start by finding the center of mass velocity of this system relative to the lab frame. So in our initial state, we have a 0.8 kilogram car moving to the right at 1.1 meters per second, a 1.3 kilogram cart moving to the left at 0.5 meters per second. And to get the center of mass velocity, we use this theorem from classical mechanics. And what this theorem says is that the net momentum of a system is equal to the total mass, I used a capital M for that, times the center of mass velocity. And I'll post a link to where this theorem was first derived. So what we need to do is get the net momentum of the system by counting up the momenta of all the moving pieces of the system. And then we set that equal to the total mass multiplied by the unknown center of mass velocity, and then we'll be able to solve for that center of mass velocity. So we plug in our numbers here, and we're using the normal convention that a rightward velocity is positive and leftward is negative. So our 0.8 kilogram cart is moving to the right at 1.1 meters per second, so it's going to have a rightward contribution to the total momentum of 0.8 times 1.1. Then the other cart is moving to the left, and it's going to have a negative momentum as a result. So the magnitude of that is 1.3 times 0.5, and I just move the minus sign out in front. And then the total mass here is 2.1 kilograms, and the center of mass velocity, that's unknown. So we clean up the left-hand side in a calculator, divide by 2.1, and we arrive at a center of mass velocity of 0.110 meters per second, just keeping three digits of precision there. Okay, now we want to use that center of mass velocity to transform this whole picture into the center of mass reference frame. And what that means is we want to imagine running along to the right at 0.110 meters per second, and then we'll ask ourselves what the initial velocities of these two carts are going to look like from that perspective. Well, as we run along to the right, it's going to make the rightward moving car look like it's moving slower. So we have a nice notation for this. We're going to say V1 initial prime is that initial velocity of cart number one in the center of mass reference frame. And again, it should look like it's moving slower now. So I have its original velocity of 1.1 meters per second. And then we're going to say minus 0.110 meters per second. And this gives us an initial velocity of 0.99 meters per second in the center of mass reference frame. Now we do the same thing for the car that was initially moving to the left. So the name for that initial velocity in the center of mass frame is V2 initial prime. And note just qualitatively here, if we start running to the right at 0.110 meters per second, it's going to make a leftward moving car look like it's moving faster. But this is actually the exact same transformation that we did to the first velocity. We just keep the minus sign on this initial velocity. It's negative 0.5 meters per second, and we transform to the center of mass reference frame by subtracting 0.110 meters per second. This gives us an initial velocity in the center of mass reference frame that has a larger magnitude, and that's negative 0.61 meters per second. So I want to take a minute here to note that there is a formal way of talking about these reference frame transformations, and I'll post a link to a video that I did on that up at the top. But we were able to handle this less formally by just asking, like for this first car that's moving to the right, well, shouldn't that look like it's moving slower when we transform to the center of mass reference frame by running to the right? And for the car initially moving to the left, well, that one should look like it's moving faster when we transform to the center of mass reference frame. So that's how we decided on subtraction for our transformation. And in fact, when we transform back to the lab frame at the end of the problem, all we have to do is use addition instead. Okay, so now we have a new perspective on our problem. We're running to the right at 0.110 meters per second in the lab. And what we see is an initial velocity on the 0.8 kilogram car of 0.99 meters per second to the right. And on the 1.3 kilogram cart, it's moving to the left at 0.61 meters per second. And now we're ready to unleash the power of the center of mass reference frame. The key fact about this reference frame is that the net momentum must be zero in the center of mass reference frame. So I'll say P net prime, just to indicate the center of mass frame, is equal to zero. Now, I covered this in my initial video on the center of mass reference frame, but just to remind you real quick why this is true, if we go back to the lab frame, we know that P net is the total mass times the center of mass velocity. Well, if I think about applying that theorem in the center of mass reference frame, in the center of mass reference frame, the center of mass velocity is zero, because this is the reference frame that tracks along with the center of mass. So we get this cool fact, the net momentum must be zero in the center of mass reference frame. And this allows us to just guess the final state of this system without having to do any algebra. So this is the point where we use the fact that in the collision, so after these cars bounce off each other, momentum and energy must both be conserved. And I know my initial momentum is zero here. The total momentum is always zero in the center of mass reference frame. And this means the rightward moving car and the leftward moving car are carrying the exact same magnitude of momentum, just in opposite directions. So if we just reverse the directions of each of these cars, but keep the same speed on them, the momentum will still be zero. And keeping the same initial speeds and just reversing the directions automatically gives us energy conservation as well. So we're going to say that V1 final in the center of mass frame, V1 final prime, is negative 0.99 meters per second. So that car is going to have the same amount of energy, but a momentum pointing in the opposite direction. And V2 final prime is going to be plus 0.61 meters per second. So again, given that in the initial state the momentum was zero, these two final velocities guarantee the momentum is still zero. We just reverse directions on each one of them, so they still add up to zero. And having the same speeds on all the same masses gives us the same total kinetic energy. So this is the whole power of the center of mass reference frame, that we're able to conserve momentum and energy without having to actually do any calculations at all. So here's what it looks like after our collision. There's the 0.8 kilogram mass moving to the left at 0.99 meters per second. The 1.3 kilogram cart moves to the right at 0.61 meters per second. And now all that's left is to transform this final state back to the lab frame to get our solution for the collision. So we know what the final state looks like when we're running to the right at 0.110 meters per second. And we just have to imagine what happens when we put on the brakes. What are the final velocities going to be now? Well, for the 0.8 kilogram car, in the center of mass frame, it looks like it's moving to the left at 0.99 meters per second, but we're running to the right at 0.11 meters per second to make it look that way. So the way we're looking at it makes it look faster than it actually is in the lab frame. So V1 final in the lab frame, so with no prime on there, is going to be a negative 0.99 meters per second plus 0.11 meters per second. This guarantees that the velocity is going to appear slower when we put on the brakes and stop running to the right. So this gives us negative 0.88 meters per second. Notice that we could also think about this more formally and just say, if it took a subtraction of 0.11 meters per second to go into the center of mass frame, then it takes the addition of 0.11 meters per second to go back to the lab frame. All right, now all we have to do is the same thing for the 1.3 kilogram mass. So I have V2 final with no prime, the final velocity in the lab, is going to be the velocity in the center of mass frame plus the velocity of the center of mass with respect to the lab. And it's probably good to always be thinking qualitatively about these things before we write down the final answer. That 1.3 kilogram car looks like it's moving 0.61 meters per second to the right in the center of mass frame. But in that frame, we're running to the right at 0.11 meters per second, which makes the car look slower than it will in the lab frame. So we want our final speed to come out bigger than it was in the center of mass frame, and it does because of that plus sign, and we end up with a final velocity of 0.72 meters per second. And I'll leave the final check to you, but what we can do is just look at this from the lab frame perspective. Compute the initial momentum and the initial kinetic energy using the initial velocities of these cars in the lab frame. Double check against the final momentum and the final kinetic energy using the two velocities that we just got. And you'll find within rounding error that these are the correct solutions. But this solution was so much better than the brute force solution of just conserving momentum and energy in the lab frame. That solution produces a nonlinear system of equations that's really ugly to solve. And instead, we just found a way to shift our perspective And we moved into a reference frame where the collision became trivial, and then we moved the final answer back into the lab frame. And that's just such a great prototype for how theoretical physics works. And that's why I always make time for the center of mass frame idea in my introductory physics courses. If you enjoyed this video, or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left, or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.